Good morning, everyone. Welcome to today's webinar, which is organized by Chandigarh Judicial Academy in collaboration with SEC Online. Today's webinar is on defenses of insurance and other related issues in accidental cases. The session would be taken care by Gopal Arasa, Dr. Gopal Arasa, who is an ADJ and a faculty member at Chandigarh Judicial Academy. As we all know, the session would be for 1 hour, 1 hour, 10-15 minutes more than that. And post the session, once the detailing has been done by Gopal Arasa, we'll get into the question answer round. Now, please be apprised that the question answers are, I would highly suggest that you put the question answer at the last, because a lot of time when the questions or answer are being asked during the session, the speaker has already covered those session, covered those topics. And reiterating those same things takes up more time, and we don't have much time left for the other questions to be answered. So let's work together and let's apply this technique of asking questions the last. Rest, everyone knows how this this thing gonna go. This recording would be available on YouTube, and the PPT would be available on the Chennai Judicial Academy website. Without any further ado, I would first welcome Gopal Arora, sir, Dr. Gopal Arora, sir, and I then request sir to please start the session. Sir, over to you.
Thank you, Chetanji. Good morning to everyone. With due regard to the Honorable High Court judges, my seniors, and my dear colleagues, basically this topic is the extension of the earlier topic which has been discussed regarding the computation of the compensation in actionable wrong cases. In the last session, we had discussed various issues regarding the calculation of the compensation in defamation cases, in malicious prosecution cases, compensation in cases of death, murder cases, and the compensation in the cases of this MACT cases. We discussed various issues and the various aspects, how the compensation is to be calculated under the different heads. The specific heads should be discussed while passing the judgment. Then the mitigating circumstances on the part of the plaintiff as well as on the part of the defendant should also be taken into consideration. And the provisions of this fatal accident are to be used by the trial judges, that is the subordinate judges, while calculating the compensation, but the formula would be same as described in the Sarla Verma's case, which is applicable to the death cases, and Rajkumar case, which is pertaining to the injury cases. And in injury cases, it has been discussed by the Honorable Supreme Court in that judgment that actual compensation, that is the actual loss suffered by the injured, should be taken into consideration, and the other head is regarding the payment of the general types of the benefits regarding the pain and suffering, loss of amenities. And regarding pain and suffering, it has been specifically mentioned by the Honorable Supreme Court in that judgment that the aid should be taken from the decisions passed by us, that is by the Honorable Supreme Court, and the various decisions given by the different Honorable High Courts. So for the calculation of the compensation under pain and suffering, the aid, we have to take the aid from the precedents. Now the question arises, suppose one precedent is presented before us, then what would be that the criteria for taking into account the quantum of the compensation? Suppose in that case the injury was pertaining to the year 1980 and the compensation of rupees 10,000 has been given. Then further, how we will calculate that compensation? One criteria has been given by the judgment that the court must consolidate, that is the cases should be fixed on one date pertaining to the nature of the similar nature of the injury. Then the computation method should be applied. And other judgment says that the method of inflation, that is the price index calculation method, can also be taken into account. Now the question arises, what is the price index calculation method? The price index calculation method is that, suppose now we are in the year 2020 year. Now we want to calculate the price index for the year 97. Then we'll go to the Google, then we'll search the price index for that year. Let's assume for the year 97, it is 30%. And for the year 2020, it is now 120%. Now the difference would be 90%. So we'll add 90% of the quantum to the quantum given in that judgment. That would be the method while calculating the compensation. Next, we have discussed about the benefits under the conventional head. And conventional head, as per the Pranoy Shetty, 10% increase has been given after every 3 years. Now, I'll left this question upon the audience, that what is the effective date of the calculation of 10% increase after every year, whether it is from the date of the judgment of the passing of the Pranay Shetty case or whether it is from the due date. Now, this controversy is still debatable. Next is regarding the apportionment of the benefits. As I have already discussed regarding the splitting of the shares. Splitting of share means if the claim has been filed by the LRs, then the calculation would be only for the benefit of the estate. If it has been filed by the dependents, then the dependency should be calculated as per the expenditure given to the dependents. So there would be a splitting of shares if there are two sets of the claimants. But if there are if the claimants are fall under the same set, that is, he falls under the definition of LRs as well as he falls under the definition of dependents, then there would be no splitting of the shares. Last time one question came that the splitting of this multiplier, but due to some misunderstanding, I explained that it may be the splitting of the shares, but the concept of splitting of shares is different from the concept of splitting of multiplier. Splitting of multiplier basically is not the terminology which is used while calculating the multiplier. And even I have searched the judgments, and our Honorable High Court basically indirectly or impliedly has passed strictures against the court who have applied that method, that is the splitting of the that multiplier. Because the multiplier has been given already settled in Sarla Verma and Pranoy Shetty case, and there is no space or there is no choice for deviating from that guidelines given by the Honorable Supreme Court in number of times. Then the next issue is this is the judgment where this the difference of this section 1 and section 2 of this fatal accident has been explained. Now it has been followed by the division bench of Calcutta High Court also, because under section 1A the benefit should be given to the dependents, and under section 2 the benefit should be given to the LRs. But now, as per the latest judgment of our Honorable Supreme Court in Barinder Singh's case, they have already explained this is the judgment. This is a judgment, National Insurance Company versus Barinder Singh. In this judgment, the Honorable Supreme Court has explained the scope of this definition of legal representative by taking the aid of section 211 of the CPC. In this particular case, this case is belonged to the Haryana state and went up to the Honorable High Court. The claimants were the major married and earning sons of the deceased, and they were considered as the legal representatives and have a right to apply for the compensation in the cases of this accidental death cases. And the earlier judgment of Manjari Behra was also taken into consideration. In Manjari Behra case, that case was filed by the daughter of that deceased, and she was also considered as the legal representative, but she was not given the full compensation, but she was only given ₹50,000 under Section 140. Now the Honorable Supreme Court has explained and distinguished this judgment that the full compensation should be given to the LRs which is pertaining to the benefits of the estate of the deceased. Now again, back to this. So now this judgment has also been followed by this Calcutta High Court. Then there was one more area that is regarding the multiplier in more than 70 years of age. No doubt the judgment of Sarala Verma says confines the period of the deceased is up to 70 years in the relevant para. But in the tables which were taken into consideration while evaluating the formula, then in all the tables there is a last column that is above 65 years. So if there is a dispute, suppose advocate argues that there is no multiplier after 70 years, then we can take the aid of that formulas given in those judgments while applying the multiplier. Now the next issue would arise in the in future also, that in this COVID situation, now we all know that there is a cut in the salaries and there is layoffs or the termination of the services of the person. So now they will take the plea regarding the fixing of the notional income of the deceased while calculating the compensation, and it is still debatable issue before us. Now the next question arises, what are the powers of the magistrate under these cases? Now as per the latest judgment of Honorable Supreme Court, in Rajesh Tyagi's case, which has been followed by the Honorable Supreme Court in further latest judgment, that the copy of a detailed accident report should be submitted before the MACT as well as before the court of magistrate. Now, what are the powers of the magistrate in this regard? Because in that judgment, it has been written if there is a violation of any provisions of MACT, then the action should be initiated against the offender. Suppose there is a finding that the person, that the driver, that the offender is having two driving licenses. One is the fake driving license and one is the original driving license. Now for the, or let's assume that he is having only one driving license, which is the fake driving license. Then for that purpose, now it is the duty of the IO to register case against him. If he doesn't register case against him, then it is the duty of the MACT or duty of the magistrate to take a report from the IO whether any action has been taken against him or not. Now this is the power of the magistrate under that judgment. Now next is again there is one gray area, that is the controversial area regarding the limitation in cases of malicious prosecution. In malicious prosecution, under Article 74 of the Limitation Act, there is a 1 year limitation for filing the suit, and it commences from the date when the complainant is acquitted or the prosecution is otherwise terminated. Now the situation arises, if revision is filed against the acquittal, or if the complainant is convicted and he files the appeal and later on acquitted, now what would be the fate in that situation? Now there are basically three situations depending upon the situation. Number one, suit filed after the decision within 1 year, that is before filing of the appeal or revision. Second is suit filed after decision within 1 year after filing of the appeal or revision, or suit filed after decision of appeal or revision within 1 year. So what would be the period of limitation? Now what is the interpretation of this word, or the prosecution is otherwise terminated? Now it has been held by the various high courts that this terminology prosecution is otherwise terminated cannot be divorced from this first limb, that is when the complainant is acquitted, that is the extended part of this limb. So meaning thereby the limitation would start after the final conclusion of the proceedings. And same view has been taken by our Honorable High Court, and now in the judgment of Delhi High Court, this issue has been taken in detail, that is the Lokchand Bansal's case. It was decided on 23rd March of 2017, and all the previous judgments were taken into consideration. And it has been held that the period of, in this case, the plaint was filed, but the plaint was rejected that it is the premature plaint. So if the appeal is pending or the appeal is filed, then suppose if the appeal is pending, then it can be rejected, returned, that this is the premature, it can be filed at the appropriate time. If it is pending and the appeal or revision has been filed, then that should, I think, to my mind, it should be sinedized, though there is no provision in our CIS software that it should not be adjourned as sinedized. So method should be invented how to deal with this situation also. Now, the another gray area regarding is section 163A. Because this section, the schedule attached to this section was amended, replaced from 22nd May of 2018. And there is also a clause of 5% increase from 1/1/2019. Now the question would arise whether this amendment would be applicable retrospectively or prospectively. This issue has been dealt with by the this Calcutta High Court in this Urmila Haldar case. In this case, the Honorable High Court has passed the judgment that it should be applied retrospectively also. And it has been observed that this is a procedural basically amendment. But if we analyze, then we can take otherwise view also, that this is not the procedural amendment, but this is a substantive amendment, because it has changed the entire structure of this section 163A by replacing the schedule. But that power has been exercised under clause 3 of this 163A, where the power has been given to the union for effecting any change under this section. So now this is also a still debatable question, and the SLP is pending before the Honorable Supreme Court, because that case was pertaining to the death case, and rupees 5 lakh lump sum was given as a compensation in the death category. But the Honorable Supreme Court has stayed this judgment, but it has been further directed to the this insurance company to pay rupees 250 lakhs to the aggrieved party, and other amount has been kept for the purpose of the decision. Now this we have already discussed, who can file the application. But for the purpose of this Fatal Accident Act, there is a class of categories who can file the petition. That is, this is a wife, husband, parent, and child. Now we are coming to the defenses of the insurance generally taken in this MACT cases. The main relevant sections pertaining to this topic are section 147, 149, 157 of the Motor Vehicle Accident Act, and another is definition portion, the another is the this road regulations. Now these road regulations, there is also a definition of this road regulations. These road regulations are very much relevant for the purpose of calculation of the compensation. Now these road regulations are also given the sanctity by the Honorable Supreme Court in these judgments. Now what is the benefit of these road regulations? Basically, road regulations were framed in the year 1989, and thereafter these were amended in the year 2017. And these were taken into consideration while calculating the negligence on the part of the driver. Now, negligence is also two types of basically negligence we take into consideration. One is contributory negligence, and another is the composite negligence. In case of this contributory negligence, there is a contribution of both the parties, and the computed compensation would be deducted as per the negligence committed by this driver. Suppose there is a 30% negligence on the part of this aggrieved party and 70% is on the part of this driver, then the compensation after calculation would be given to the extent of 70% to the this aggrieved party. In case of composite negligence, there would be a negligence by two persons, but the aggrieved party is the third person. So he can claim the compensation from two persons jointly and severally, and he is having the option, even he can obtain 100% compensation even from one party who is having the sufficient resources. So this was all about regarding this negligence part. And for the calculation of this contributory negligence, we take the aid of these regulations. The offences basically, the defences basically taken by the insurance company are explained in detail in the judgment of Swaran Singh case, which is pertaining to the 2004 year. It has been categorically mentioned by the Honorable Supreme Court that the insurance company can take into account all the defences contained in Section 149 of the Motor Vehicle Act. But it is the duty of, firstly, it is the duty of the insurance company to specifically plead those defenses and to lead the evidence for proving those defenses. But the question has been left open by the Honorable Supreme Court that what should be the criteria for proving these defenses, because it will depend upon the nature of the case and it will vary from case to case. That case basically pertaining to the fake driving license and the concept of this effective driving license and duly licensed has been discussed in this judgment, because Section 3 of this Motor Vehicle Act talk about this driving license, okay, which is the effective driving license, whereas Section 149 says that the duly licensed. Now the word duly licensed has been explained by the Honorable Supreme Court by observing that the duly licensed means that he was earlier having the license. So though it may be fake driving license, he has been disqualified or he has not get renewed it. So all these circumstances cover the concept of this duly licensed, meaning thereby he was having earlier driving license, but at the time of this accident, there was some default on the part of this driver. So this judgment gives the view regarding this the defenses to be taken by the this insurance company, and one formula was also evaluated on the basis of clause 4 and clause 5 of this section 149, where it has been mentioned that in case of any violation, first, the compensation is to be paid by the insurance company, then it is to be recovered from the owner of the vehicle. That is the pay and recover principle has been, though it is contained in the act, but it has been explained by the judgment by the Honorable Supreme Court. Now, the next issue taken by the this judgment regarding the this duties of the owner while employing the person as a driver. So what are the duties of the owner? Then he must take the due care while employing any person as a driver, whether he is having this valid driving license, but he is not duty bound to get it verified whether it is a fake driving license or not. Suppose he has taken the test of the driver and simply seen the driving license of the person, then this is a sufficient requirement and this is a sufficient care taken by the owner of this vehicle. Now these are the various issues regarding this driving license. One, whether the person is holding the driving license different from the vehicle he is plying. Suppose a person is having driving license of three wheeler, but he is driving the scooter and has caused the accident. Now, whether this is a valid driving license in the eyes of law, this is again open question. Then fake driving license, whether he is having the fake driving license. Now, if he is having the fake driving license, that license has no meaning in the eyes of law. Then this principle of pay and recover would be applicable. Then suppose the fake driving license has been renewed and the new license is a valid driving license. Now, what is the value of that valid driving license in the eyes of law? Now, as per the settled law, that license has no meaning and that is not the valid driving license in the eyes of the law. Now, the next situation, if the driver is holding two driving licenses, one is fake and one is a genuine driving license, then earlier there were the judgments that if he is having one valid driving license, then that is the valid driving license. But now, as per the latest judgment of this Rajesh Tyagi case, where the concept of DAR has been evolved, now it is the duty of the IO to get registered case if he is holding any fake driving license. And I have already explained that is the duty of the now MHCT as well as a magistrate to get registered take the report of the IO regarding this concept. Next is the driving license applied for the renewal. Suppose if it has been expired and under the provisions of Motor Vehicle Act, there is a period of this grace period of 30 days for applying for the renewal of the license. And that suppose if the accident occurred during that period, now whether he comes under the definition of his duly licensed or not. Suppose if he has applied before the occurrence of accident, then he is having the valid driving license because it will be renewed from the date when it expires. But if he applies the driving license after the last of 30 days, then that would not relate back to the date of expiry, but that would relate back to the date of the applying of the driving license. So then he would not be having the valid driving license. Next issue is regarding whether he is having any valid driving license for these plying these hazardous substances vehicles. Then the license also requires the endorsement in that case. The next issue is regarding this holding of this driving license, this LMV, light motor vehicle accident. Now, as per this latest judgment of Honorable Supreme Court, we have to go by the definition portion also. Okay, what is this heavy goods vehicle? What is this light motor vehicle? Now, the categorization has been made in cases of these transport vehicles on the basis of the weight of the vehicle. If it comes under the weight of this 7500 kgs, then the light motor vehicle is required, whether it may be a motor car, tractor, road roller. And this weight must include the extra weight carried by the vehicle, that is this extra tire, tools box. It should include the interpretation of law is this, that the this weight should be including those components also. Then unladen weight, then the definition of this driving license, then gross vehicle weight, then this is the judgment given by the Honorable Supreme Court by taking into consideration these various definitions that the light motor vehicle license would include these types of the vehicles as per this judgment. Now, these are the judgments I have already discussed in the cases of this two driving license. The list of these judgments I will circulate later on. And these are the various issues pertaining to the driving license. Now, the next issue is regarding this registration certificate. Registration certificate is basically connected with the transfer of the vehicle. Suppose if a vehicle is transferred by way of affidavit and the transfer is still under the process, that is with the RTO office, or maybe within 30 days or within 15 days, he is yet to apply, but the accident occurs within 7 days of the this transfer of the vehicle. Then what is the fate of fate regarding the owner of the vehicle? Now, as per the latest judgment of this 2020 judgment of Honorable Supreme Court and this 2019 judgment also, this 2020 judgment, this Shiri Anthony judgment also. Now it has been categorically held by the Honorable Supreme Court that the previous owner would be liable until and unless the name of the transferee is reported in the office of the RTO basically records. So even if the this transfer is in the process of this documentation, even then no benefit should be given to the owner. So these are the judgments pertaining to the transfer of vehicle. Now the next issue is regarding the insurance policy. Now it also falls under the this provisions of section 149 of this Motor Vehicle Act. There may be a violation of the insurance policy, there may be a conditions of the violation of the policy, whether this is regarding the nature of the policy, whether this is the effective date of the policy. So there is a list of these instances where the defenses accrues to the insurance party. Now first is regarding the nature of the policy. Now the nature of the policy, we can say, in the latest judgment of Honorable Supreme Court, now it has been given the direction to various agencies or to the this the insurance companies to get compulsorily register the vehicles at the time of this purchase. Though the this option has been given to the party whether to take the third party insurance or to take the comprehensive policy. Now we'll understand the meaning of this act policy and this comprehensive policy. This is the basic judgment of this Balakrishnan judgment, where the difference of this act policy or the comprehensive or we can say package policy has been explained. Now for while calculating the compensation of the deceased and as per the nature of this deceased person or nature of this policy, we will calculate the compensation on the basis of this policy. Suppose if act policy has been issued and comprehensive policy, that is package policy, has not been issued, then under the act policy, suppose if it is a case of pillion rider, then he is not entitled for any compensation. But if it is a comprehensive policy, then he would come under the definition of this third party. Because the basic idea, that is the basic concept of insurance companies, is that as per the Motor Vehicle Act, they only provide the compensation to the third party. So if it is a comprehensive policy, then the pillion rider is covered. Otherwise, the pillion rider is not covered if it is a act policy. Now, it has been observed in the judgment that as per the IRDA instructions, this comprehensive policy covers this pillion rider as well as the other occupants of the car also, because this under the car, that is the driver as well as the maybe cleaner or maybe one person, suppose if it is covered on the payment of the premium. What is the fate about the other occupants? So if it is a comprehensive policy, then the others are covered under that policy. If it is the act policy, then that are the not covered. But in the latest judgment of our Honorable High Court, in Shiv Lochan's judgment, it has been now clarified by discussing the old provisions of the Act, that is Section 94 of this Motor Vehicle Act, as well as this section, parallel Section 149 of this Motor Vehicle Act, that if there is no distinction between act policy as well as this comprehensive policy, if it is act policy, even then this pillion rider, the other occupants of the these vehicles are also covered for the purpose of this compensation. So this is the basically, I want to say that the difference, that is the nature of the policy, would determine regarding this the how to calculate the compensation, and which cases the compensation needs to be given, which cases the compensation is not to be given. Second category is regarding the effective date of this insurance policy or the policy, or maybe it is cover note also. Now, the effective date, suppose if the time has been given in the policy at the time, initiation of the time, then that would prevail. But if no time has been mentioned, suppose today is the 7th of this August, and the policy bears the date of 7th August, then it would run from the night of this 12 a.m. the 12 o'clock. Otherwise, if the time is written, suppose it is from this 11 a.m., then it would be affected from the 11 a.m. This is Shobhina Lakai's case. Then lifelong, that is one time premium. If suppose one time premium has been given in the at the time of insurance, then the loss is in that situation. Suppose if the vehicle is having the life of this 15 years, as per in now in the new notification, that this diesel vehicles are having 10 years, this petrol are having 15 years, then the policy would lapse after the lapsing of these 15 years. That would be the life of insurance policy. Suppose it is, suppose 5 years are extended by the RTO, then the policy would not be this extended. He will have to take the this new insurance policy. Then next is the issue regarding these insurance policies are regarding these commercial vehicles are attached to the schools. Suppose if a commercial vehicle is attached to the school, whether separate this insurance policy is required? No. The law says, the Honorable Supreme Court says, that there is no such requirement, and this original policy would be valid policy. Then next is the premium paid by the LRs of dead owner. Suppose the owner is died and the premium is paid by the LRs, and the vehicle has not been transferred in the name of the LR. Whether that is a valid contract under the eyes of law. Now, in as per the Santro Devi's case, this is a valid contract and the policy is a valid policy because the vehicle has been insured. It has nothing to do with these LRs or with the owner. Now, the next is suppose at the time of purchase of the policy, the payment is made through the check. Now, what would be the fate of that policy if the check is dishonored and the accident is occurred in the meantime? Now, the law is this. Suppose the check is dishonored and the intimation has been given by the bank to the insurance company, but the insurance company intimates to the this insurer regarding the dishonor of check, and the accident occurs after the intimation, then that is the invalid policy, and even the insurance company is not liable in those cases. If the accident occurs prior to the intimation, then the insurance company would pay the this compensation, but principle of pay and recover would be applicable. It has been discussed by the Honorable Supreme Court in this Lakshama case by discussing all these Didappa, Inderjeet Kaur Rulla, and Seema Malhotra case. All these cases were discussed in details, and this judgment has been passed. And the next issue is regarding this permit and route permits. Now, under section 149, the word permit has been used, but route permit has not been used under section 149. Now, the insurance companies or the other parties take this defense that the route permit is missing in this case, and the permit would not extend the word route also. So this is not the valid defense with the insurance companies. But now, in the year 2000, this 18 Amritpal Singh's case, and even Punjab and Haryana High Court, this Banesh and Syed, and even MVD, this is the 2019 judgment, MVD something where the bus was attached with the school. And even in that case, there was a dispute regarding the route permit, and it has been categorically held that the defense regarding this route permit can also be can take this can, the insurance company can take this defense also. So this was all about this route permit. Now the next issue is regarding this proof of evidence. Even in Solzing's case, it has been this held by the Honorable Supreme Court regarding the proof of these defenses, that it varies from case to case and it depends on the circumstances of the case. And now what is the this duty of the complainant to prove his case? That is also on the basis of preponderance of probability. And the this the observations in the criminal judgment are not applicable to the MSCT proceedings, because it has been held by the Honorable Supreme Court. Suppose this MSCT Motor Vehicle Tribunal takes the assistance of the site plan annexed in the this criminal proceedings, then what would be the fate? The site plan in the criminal cases would be prepared at the time after the occurrence of the accident, and it would not give the this clear picture regarding the negligence, how it happened, how the accident was happened. So in the MSCT proceeding, it is to be decided by way of an independent evidence. But in this Mangla's case, this Mangla Ram judgment 2018 case, it has been held by Honorable Supreme Court that the filing of charge sheet against this driver is prima facie points towards the element of negligence, but it is to be independently proved in the MSCT cases. This was regarding this proof. Suppose a person is acquitted, or if there is no FIR, or even if there are proceedings under Section 174 of the CRPC for filing of the these proceedings, then whether MSCT this claim petition is maintainable, the law is well settled that the claim petition is maintainable, compensation can be claimed. And there are the argument is raised in the judgments that since the witnesses have been resiled in the criminal case, and it is a fraud upon the MSCT, this is the tribunal. But the Honorable High Court in the latest judgment has held that this is not a fraud upon this MSCT, and the compensation can be given, because this is a beneficial legislation. Basically, this is the intent of the legislation. Now the other circumstances which are also related to the defenses to be taken by the insurance company are this gratuitous persons. What is the status of these persons? Now I have already discussed that as per the Shivlochan judgment, every person is this included in the category of these types of the cases. Now the next issue arises regarding the borrower of the vehicle. Suppose if a person has borrowed the vehicle, and now the as per this latest judgment, he will step into the shoes of the owner. By stepping into the shoes of the owner, and his status would be equivalent to the status of the owner. And suppose if no other vehicle is involved, and the single vehicle is involved which he was plying, then he is not entitled for the compensation. Now the next question arises, suppose a person is driving a vehicle and causes an accident with the other vehicle. The occupants of other vehicle, injured or maybe deceased, will claim against that person, that is from the insurance company of that person. Now the question arises whether this person who is at fault can file claim petitions for injuries under Section 13A of the this Act on the basis of this fault liability, because now it is the law is well settled that 163 is pertaining to the fault liability also, and even it comes under the strict liability basically. Now there is a cross set of petitions whether it can be filed. It is again still debatable question ke whether this application is maintainable under the eyes of law by the offender. Now, as per this Ram Khiladi judgment, that owner cannot file the application for the compensation if there is only one vehicle is involved. But in this case, Mehrana's case in 2018, our Honorable High Court has held that if it is a comprehensive policy, then he is covered because it is this judgment has distinguished the basic judgment of Honorable Supreme Court in Nigama's case. Nigama's case has been distinguished by our Honorable High Court in Mehrana's case in 2018. But now my respectful submission is this, that after this year 2020, now which judgment would prevail? This is passed by the Honorable Supreme Court that now this owner, if the one vehicle is involved, whether the policy is act policy or the this comprehensive policy, he is not entitled for any compensation. Now the next issue comes regarding this overloading of the this maybe it may be a goods or it may be the passengers. Suppose in the case of passengers, now what would be the fate? Suppose if there is a insurance of 6 persons and there are 9 occupants in the car, so what would be the fate of 3 persons? Now it is the well settled principles of Honorable Supreme Court in this Anjana Shyam's case that the compensation would be given in all the cases, but regarding 3 left out, the payment should be recovered under the this pay and recover principle. Now the question arises, what type of amount should be recovered? That is the highest amount or the lowest amount? The law says that is the highest amount. The highest amount would be paid by the insurance company and the lowest amount would be recovered. Now the next question comes regarding this dangerous position vehicle, that is the standing vehicle on the road, that is the stationary vehicles. As per these provisions, it is also the duty of the this driver or the owner to park the vehicle at a safe place or by giving the indicators or by giving the reflectors regarding this the stationed vehicle. Now, as per this 2020 judgments, now the law is very well settled. Earlier there were judgments that it is a case of contributory negligence, that it is contributed by the this deceased also in the cases of this, or the petition is not maintainable against the stationary vehicle. But now the law is well settled that there is no scope of this contributory negligence if the vehicle is standard or parked without any reflectors or without taking any due care by the driver. Now the next is regarding this striking of the this vehicle against the basically tree. We can say if the vehicle is stuck against the tree, whether compensation can be given in this situation. Now in the latest judgment, Honorable Supreme Court in this year 2018, it has been held that in this situation, no compensation can be given to the deceased or to the injured person also. Now the one question remains regarding this 163A, that the controversy is still open, whether it is applicable retrospectively or prospectively. In the new structured this formula, that is 5 lakhs lump sum compensation and 250 lakh, and the word has been described as for the grievous injury. Now the grievous injury word has been mentioned. Suppose he has spent rupees 10 lakhs upon the treatment. Now whether he is entitled for this compensation under section 163A, the question is still open. Because this new amended provision does not talk about these types of benefits. So there are certain gray areas in also this section 163 in the amended provision also. So it was all about the defenses of the cases, and I have also recapped the earlier this section and these are the basically main defenses. These are taken by the insurance companies. Now the other ancillary issues attached to these provisions are regarding this. Suppose if an employee who is covered under the this employee's insurance company, whether he is entitled for compensation under this Motor Accident Act or he will claim the compensation under the ESI Act. As per Section 53 of Employee State Insurance Act, he will claim the compensation from the employer if he is claiming the compensation for the acts done or occurred during the course of employment, or it is attached with that, or it is the notional extension of the employment. So the law is well settled, then he will claim from the employer. But suppose if he is going to his house, then he met with an accident, then he will claim the benefits under the this MACT Act. And there is also an option, okay, he can file the application before the Workmen Compensation Act, now it is the Employee Compensation Act, or under the MACT also. So it was this pertaining to the other issues are regarding these execution proceedings. For execution purpose, we will basically take a separate session pertaining to these executions of MACT cases, as well as the executions of these land acquisition cases. And the other issues are regarding this apportionment. Apportionment I have already discussed, and regarding the interest part. Now the interest part, there is a specific provision under the Act that the interest would be given from the date of the filing of the application, and it is the discretion of the court to give this interest. And generally the courts earlier were giving 9% interest, but now there are certain judgments that 7% interest, 6% interest. But there is a provision that 30 days time should be given to the insurance companies. So if we impose the default clause, then the 30 days period should be given to the insurance company, then the 30 days, this 1 month should be, I think, deducted from that part while granting the interest, because this is a statutory benefit given to the insurance company for the compliance of the award. So these were the main general, these are the related issues regarding this insurance defenses or the claim petitions. Rest of all we'll discuss in this question and answer session if any issue arises. So Mr. Chetan, I have concluded my lecture, and now we can open this question and answer session.
Sir, thank you so much, sir. I think we have just finished the session on time. I would request all the members to put up their questions in the question answer round, question section of this webinar. In the meantime, I have one question, sir. And I'll just raise that question for now. The question is notification regarding life of vehicle has a retrospective effect or a prospective effect?
That's life the first of question. Vehicle.
Yeah, life of vehicle. Is it has a retrospective effect or a prospective effect? That is, life of vehicle is to be determined on the basis of notification existing on the date of purchase of a new vehicle, or it would be affected by the subsequent notifications.
Basically, as per the judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court regarding the interpretation of this concept, the applicability of the provisions is to be seen on various factors. Basically, as per the general clauses that it is to be repealed, and new these provisions are applicable, and as per the other criteria, if any benefit is earlier accrued, that cannot be taken away. If any extra benefit has been given, then it will relate back to the, now the nature as well as the circumstances are to be seen under which this notification has been passed. So regarding this, no concrete finding can be given whether it would be applicable, because it is a matter of the interpretation by the Honorable High Court or by the Honorable Supreme Court, whether it should be retrospectively applicable or it should be this applicable prospectively?
So moving to the next question, again about the life of the vehicle, but in respect to if there's a in respect to the MSCT cases. The question is, if a person driving a vehicle, and now over here the vehicle has been taken as that it has already outlived its notified life, dies in an accident due to alleged negligence of a driver of other vehicle, then the first scenario, what benefit can accused, that is the driver of offending vehicle, can take in the trial court under section 304A of IPC of the fact that the deceased was driving a vehicle which has outlived its notified life? Second question, sub question is, whether in such case LRs of deceased can get compensation under MSCT Act?
No, definitely, it hardly matters whether he was sitting, the deceased was sitting in the outlived vehicle. It has nothing to do with 304A, number one. Secondly, this regarding compensation, he is also entitled for compensation. So, see, the violation, suppose if there is any violation of this Motor Vehicle Act, maybe regarding driver license, regarding permit, maybe the party is liable individually. But for the purpose of compensation, compensation is to be paid. So in this case, both the situation, 304 is also the accused is liable for 304 AIPC. And for the purpose of compensation, he is also entitled for compensation.
Very well, sir. I think that's a very clear distinction of, like you said, that if the permit and everything is not there, he will be, it's something that he has to dealt separately. Mm-hmm. And MSCT would...
because in the latest judgment, this Honorable Supreme Court, Rajesh Tyagi's case, this is the duty of the now IO. To get registered, suppose this is a case of this case, or there is a violation of any of the provisions, all the provisions are given in the pro forma given under that judgment.
Sure.
That the action should be taken against the this offending party.
So noted.
Maybe driver, maybe owner.
Okay. So for now, I think we. I think for now we have don't have any questions. I will request other members to now members to put more questions if they have any. So otherwise, this PPT would be available on the
yes,
website.
Yes.
Academy website, right, sir? Because there were a lot of citations that you shared, like always, and during the session.
Basically, this MSCT law is derived by way of these judgments. Provisions are very short provisions and few provisions, but interpretation is more elaborately done by the Honorable Supreme Court on various issues regarding compensation, defenses. Sometimes this two judges bench comes, then three judges bench comes. So I have highlighted basically the settled propositions of the law. How it dwelled, that is the now, this is the old law, that is not very much relevant basically. But I have highlighted the latest judgments pertaining to these all these issues.
Makes sense, sir. I think makes sense. And that's why I also said the same thing, that the citations are very important and members would like to go through it again.
Even this, we'll upload these PPTs on this Academy site.
Academy site, very well, sir. I think that's what we've been doing. That we've been doing in the previous session as well. All the
right.
These are already there on the website. Sir, moving to the next question. The question is, when a person has gone abroad on short visit, and he was also insured, but he gets sick in abroad, where he can file the case of claim. He can file case after coming to India or before that. So basically, he got sick. So I think the question is that he got sick. He was insured in India, but he got sick while he was traveling abroad. So can he claim of the expenses that he would have incurred in other country should he apply for the expenses or the claim while he is there, or should he wait to come back to India and then claim for it?
Compensation under which act?
So this is for insurance. It sounds like a medical.
That is a, that is, I think that is a general insurance. Basically, this is a, this matter is pertaining to this Consumer Protection Act. Basically, the remedies under Consumer Protection Act for that is for these diseases. I think it is pertaining to disease policy.
Yes, sir.
Regarding the sickness policy.
Yes, yes.
So even no doubt the this remedy of civil court is also applicable, but. If he is, maybe he can file from anywhere. He is covered under the policy, basically.
Sir, I think isn't it? I'm just asking. Sir, isn't it about? It's also that if that policy is even applicable international on the international, again, beyond the international.
I am going to add. If there is any violation of the policy, if there is any clause regarding this. He will be entitled only for the disease occurred in India, then yes. Then naturally he will be bound by that condition.
Yes.
But if it is a general policy, he may the disease may be attributed to anyone.
Certainly, sir. So then he can claim accordingly, either from there or either once.
Obviously. Basically, law of this insurance is pertaining. This is a contractual liability. We have to go by the terms and conditions of the policy.
Absolutely, sir. Sir, I think we don't have any further questions. And this is not the first time I'm saying this to you. I think in your sessions, usually I get very few questions. So it's actually a compliment. And Neeraj Goyal, sir, JMIC from Khanna District Court, who's very, very, I see Mr. Goyal sir's name in every session in the question answer round, and he has asked me to convey his compliments to you. I'll read out his compliment. He says, "Sir, the beauty of your lecture is to admit about the gray areas in law and leave those areas to be wisdom of audience." So I think this is actually very important, because when we are trying to address something and admitting that there is a flaw, but also giving that, telling everyone that everything should be taken with a pinch of salt. I think that's the quality that a good speaker always has. And I think that's what Neeraj Goyal sir is saying with his compliment over here. And I totally agree with this, sir.
Because definitely actually in these gray areas, I can't impose my opinion. It is open to all, because everyone is having his own perception, his own opinion. How to interpret that provision, and if it is interpreted by the Honorable High Court or by the Supreme Court, then that is binding upon.
I think that is the that's exactly what others are also saying, that admitting it and then saying it that this is the gray area, and I think that's more important part. And the reason why we don't have any questions, because there's another compliment saying that, sir, it was a very informative lecture and you have explained it elaboratively. And there's another, some anonymous member has said thank you so much, and I'm sure a lot of members would have been would have the same feeler about your session. So sir, if you allow, we can end this session now. We can conclude this session.
But in the last, I would.
I'm so sorry. So we have two more questions. Just came in.
Yes.
Sir, I'm so sorry. So the question is, what is the effect of acquittal of a driver of offending vehicle from the charges of negligent driving on merits by criminal court while adjudicating claim petition by MACT?
I have already explained regarding this, that in the cases of this MACT, the tribunal would judge the negligence on the basis of preponderance of the probabilities. Whereas in the cases of these criminal trials, that is the concept of beyond reasonable doubt is applicable. So the claim petition is maintainable, and it is to be seen by the this tribunal. And that judgment is not binding. I have already stated that in Mangala's case 2018, the Honorable Supreme Court has restricted the stage up to the filing of the charge sheet. filing of charge sheet prima facie indicates the negligence, but it is to be proved by the preponderance of the probabilities in the claim petition. So it would be having no effect upon this proceedings of this amnesty. And suppose the witnesses are resiled in a criminal case and a person is acquitted, even that judgment is not binding, and no opinion can be sought from that judgment.
Certainly, sir.
Next.
So, talking about interim compensation, sir, the question is that is there any fixed amount of the in regards to interim compensation to be paid in MSCT? If there is, then in what stage is it to be paid?
No, interim compensation, basically regarding this interim compensation, under MSCT, there are three types of litigation. Basically, one is under this section 140 of Motor Vehicle Act. These provisions are no doubt are under the face of these amendments, but the act is yet to be amended. This 2019 act is yet to be amended. Certain provisions are made applicable, but certain are yet to be these amended as per section 1 of this 2019 act. Now, the second is regarding this 163A, that is fault liability, or strict we can say also strict liability. Third is under section 166 of the Motor Vehicle Act. Now, under section 140 and 163A, we can choose only one remedy. Under section 140, there is a provision of this interim compensation, that is up to this 50,000 in death cases, or 25,000 on the basis of the injury. But generally, they file this, they make prayer under the petition under 166 regarding this 140. But generally, interim compensation is not paid, and it is decided at the time of this main or final disposal of the petition. So, to my mind, it will not vary from area to area, but it has been given under the statute. And the other type of litigation comes through DART, the detailed accident report, or the AIR. Basically, earlier it was AIR, that is accident information report, under section 158 of this Motor Vehicle Act. So the interim compensation is only this is the pertaining to this given in section 140 of this Motor Vehicle Act. Even that can be decided. There are certain judgments that should be decided at the earliest, so that some interim compensation is to be should be given to the party. But generally, advocates concede that please don't decide this application, and it would be decided at the time of final argument of this petition under 166 of the Motor Vehicle Act. Now these provisions are under amendment, basically in the 2000. I have already explained 2019 Act. Now, earlier 1988 Act, suppose there is no limitation for filing this claim petition. But now, under the new Act, there is a provision of 6 months for filing the claim petition from the date of death. This is one of the major change in the new Act, but it is yet to be implemented. Regarding this place of suing, earlier in the 1988 Act, suppose there is a where the accident occurred, or where this claimant resides, or where he carries on his business, those are the places where he can file the petition. Now the head office of the insurance companies are also added in the new Act. Under the new Act, there is also provisions of this golden hour schemes. Compensation is to be paid from these common funds, but there are certain conditions and parameters how these interim compensations are to be paid. We have to wait for the implementation of this new Act.
Sir, I think now we have answered all the questions. Sir, before I conclude, sir, anything that you would like to say? Also, can you hear me?
Is there any question?
No, sir. There are no questions, sir. Anything now before we conclude? Anything that you would like to say, sir?
I would like to add regarding this defenses. one thing I left that is regarding section 147 of this Motor Vehicle Act. Suppose it is a goods vehicle, then in that category, the owner of the goods or a person authorized by him is automatically covered under the insurance policy. Now, suppose if a vehicle starts from one place for the purpose of carrying, suppose, vegetables from this vegetable market, that is the goods vehicle, and person is sitting, representative or owner is sitting in that vehicle, and accident occurs before reaching to this vegetable market. Now, whether that person is covered under that policy or not, whether if he will come under the purview of this section 147 of Motor Vehicle Act. Now, it has been interpreted by this aspect also, that when the vehicle starts, the moment the vehicle starts, it would also come under the definition of that area basically. Because the vehicle has been initiated for the purpose of carrying out the goods, there is no need that the goods should be present upon the vehicle. So this is also some new situation, and sometimes we confuse that this vehicle is not carrying any goods, but how the benefit would be given to this section 147 of this Motor Vehicle Act. So it has been clarified by our honorable in this situation also.
So, thank you for adding that element as well, sir. I think this is good because it was not asked, but I'm sure you noted that point that it might be a question in the future as well. Sir, thank you. My personal thanks, because I know it and I always say it that these presentations are not only 1 hour presentation. There's a lot of work that goes behind these presentations. So I know it. You obviously know it. It is my responsibility to share the same thing with our audience as well. So thank you for that, sir, and thank you for your taking your time. And on behalf of Chandigarh Judicial Academy, on behalf of SEC Online, on behalf of Dr. Gopal Vora, sir, I would like to thank all the members who have joined in from across the districts of PNH. High Court, Honorable High Court judges have joined in today's session. Without the audience, the speaker will talk, but it will not reach to the masses. The purpose will not be solved. It's a circle that has to be completed. So a speaker is important, so is the audience. So on behalf of everyone, I would like to personally thank all the members who take out time every time we have this session, and ask questions to not only get clarification to their queries, but also help each other by asking queries. With this, we'll conclude today's session, and we'll be back next week. The new dates and the new topic will be shared with you in the usual manner. So we end this now. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Chetanji, and regard to my all the participants, the honorable judges and the honorable seniors and my colleagues. I am very thankful for their participation and for this, because by way of participation we also improve our basically lecture. I have repeated number of times that we are not teaching anybody, because this is a platform where we can discuss our problems. And I always come with these types of problems and with these gray areas. So we can also get an idea from these ignited minds and from these various, because when we sit together, we can work well and we can invent new ideas, and new ideas come basically from these brainstorming sessions. So this is a basic idea regarding this conducting these webinars. I am again very thankful to my honorable judges and my learned director academy and director administration, and this particularly this SEC team for giving us this platform for discussing these all areas with all the judges of both the states as well as Chandigarh and even outside the yes. jurisdiction of our honorable. Thank you so much, Chetanji. Thank you
so much. Pleasure, sir. Thanks. So we'll end this session now, sir. Thank you.